I'm here to present a tool called StopStalk. Let's see what it's about. So here I am. My name is Raj. I'm founder at StopStalk. I also work at Process Stack as a software engineer. And So how many of you guys know what competitive programming websites are? Okay, it doesn't matter. I'll explain it. Yeah. So let's go through a few terminologies that I'll be using in this presentation. The first one being a problem. So what is the problem statement? So basically what you need is a problem statement which requires some code to solve it. So for example, say you have to write a program to accept two numbers and print the output of it. So you take 2 and 5 as input and you print 7 in STDO, right? And there is something called constraint to the problem. Constraints is basically what would the input numbers be like. So here in our case, we are having that you'll have all the numbers in the input with digit size 1000. Like a number would be having more than exactly 1000 digits. Then the submission. Submission is basically the actual code snippet which would solve the problem. So let's see how a C++ program would look. So you declare two variables, take x and y, and just print the output, right? Will it work? Should it work? Let me go to the previous slide. The constraints here are the number has 1000 digits in it. Should this work? Yes, no. No, because the int can't handle that many digits in the size, right? How about this Python code? Should work, right? Because Python handles everything very awesomely, so you don't need to worry about the constraints on the digits, okay? So that is basically submission, the code snippet which solves the problem. Then there is something called submission status. So what happens is these websites have an option to upload your code and they'll give you these status. So the first one is accepted. So they have a list of test cases which they run against your code. And they'll give you these statuses based on what your code is giving out. The second is when every test case is passed. Wrong answer is one of the test cases failed. Time limit exceeded is basically your code snippet. It's taking a lot of time to execute. Memory limit is basically you have declared an array that is not actually required in the solution. So it will give you a memory limit exceeded error. Runtime error is basically if your code is giving some check fault or something on some test case, right? Then there are contests. So contests are basically there are a few problems which you need to solve in a limited time period, and what matters here is your speed and the accuracy. So if you submit a wrong answer the first time, you will be penalized with some amount of rating, and based on that your rating would be computed when the contest is over. And there are various problem difficulty levels, and each problem can be easy or a bit hard to solve. And once all the contest is over, there are ratings that are allocated to the user, and based on the performance you get some prizes or something based on the contest performance. Okay, and this is a generic one. So handle is basically on a particular website, if you have a username or handle, that is the unique identifier of the user on the website. Cool. So yeah, any questions till now with the terminologies? Cool. So what are the competitive programming websites now? So these websites have a bunch of problems which you can code submission there, and they'll give you various statuses across that. And that is how basically you learn algorithmic programming and basically logical thinking. Yeah, so where did the idea of StopStalk come from? So I was in second year, and what we used to do is we used to see each other's profiles, my friends' profiles, across various competitive programming websites. I'll open every URL and then check what the person is doing, what kind of problems he's solving, what kind of categories it's included in the problem. And yeah, so basically that. So what I would do is, say my friend's name is Pranjal, and his Codeforces handle is PranjalR34. I'll open codeforces.com/profile/PranjalR34 and see what the problem he is solving. On CodeChef, if I want to check, I'll check codeChef.com/user/PranjalR34. Spodge, I'll check spodge.com/status/PranjalR34. But if I see on Hacker Earth, he has a different handle. HackerEarth.com/submissions/Pranjal.Rai.121. Now, how do I remember all of these handles? And this is just one of the friends which I'm checking. And say if I have like 10 friends. So remembering all the handles across the websites is pretty cumbersome, right? So how is the checking of profiles helping? So I can know what kind of problems he's solving. I can attempt on it. And say if I'm stuck, I'll get help from him. And also, so in vacations, right, you are not doing anything productive, like apart from Netflix or something. So yeah, and so that was a great source of motivation to work harder to get an internship in the third year, right? So that was basically it. And how it all started was, I started writing Python scripts which would retrieve data from each of the sites with providing a specific set of handles. I'll just remember these handles for now. So I don't actually ask my friends. I'll just Google it and find some handle, and I'll just add it to my Python script. And I just created a dashboard which looks something like this. So each row in this picture is basically a submission. Submission is basically the code snippet that is solved. So first is the name, then the site name, then the site profile, and time of submission, the problem name, the language of submission, and the submission status. Right? So this was the basic dashboard that I came up with in the starting. That was just crawling and just getting this data. So what I realized is, across the span of 5 to 10 days, I got a lot of submissions across all the friends of mine. So why just stop at submissions when you can have a lot of data analyzed based on these submissions? Now these submissions are not just submissions, but actually the complete competitive programming progress of that user, right? Because everything is covered, every site is covered, and I just need to open the profile. Right, so yeah, how many of you guys know this graph? Cool, yes, we are at first, right? So, yeah, so first attempt on the submissions database was this. So every basically green dot is the amount of contributions on a particular website, submissions on the particular website, right? Cool, so not just this was just one of the graphs. So let's go through a lot of features that I could just pull out from that submissions database. So the main inherent thing in StopStalk was to analyze your friend's progress, and along with that, you make changes with your progress too. So how does it help? So the basic thing is, if you see your friend's submissions, you will just go to your friend and ask to explain some problem. But there are also editorials on the problems. Every problem has an editorial. So if that editorial is enough for the person to learn from that, we wouldn't need friends. Right? So friends. So basically, what can I say? Yeah. So a friend explaining reading a editorial which is quite cryptic, along with that very short too. So that always helps. Then there is this thing that you read people's code and learn from it. That's the most best thing that you can do. Software engineering is all about it. You have to read the code. If you are good at it, you are good at software engineering. Yeah. So so we started as friend request feature. So what we used to do is basically users would register on our website and we can send friend requests to each other so that each other can see submissions. But we eventually stopped that feature because people used to not accept the friend request, or there's no as such data which is private, so why not just add the friend directly. So we just removed that feature. So now you can just add a friend and your submissions would be visible to other friends, right? So the dashboard looks something like this right now. Each row is a submission, user, site profile, the same thing. And you also have an option to view or download that code directly from StopStalk. Now, what you can do is also search problems from tags. So every problem has some specific tag. So tag is basically, say, dynamic programming, or say easy or greedy or binary, what that problem requires you to solve. So every problem, say our problem was just add two numbers, it could have an easy tag or it could have implementation tag, right? So every problem has these tags. Now every website has different tag names. So dynamic programming might be written as DP, just DP. So on Codeforces you will have only DP as the tag name. On HackerRank, you will have dynamic hyphen PROG as the tag. So if a user wants to search by it, he would actually want to search dynamic programming and not just DP, just dynamic hyphen programming. Similarly for bit manipulation, you will have bitwise hyphen operation and then bit manipulation. So what you want is something which clusters this for you and gives you all the problems which are from that category, right? So this is what the search problems by tags page look like. So in the left, you can just search for the problem, the problem tag, which can be actual tag, just the DP. But if you enter it on the right side, we'll just club that for you and give you all the problems which are for dynamic programming. You can see the tag names there. These are the site tags actually. So we search for dynamic programming and we get all the dynamic programming problems. So user can just search it, choose any of the problem and solve it, right? Now there is a page called trending problems. So a user wants to see how other coders are doing, how other contests are, like he'll have to see ki, how other people, which all problems are people solving. So what they'll do is they'll just go on the sites and see the problems and then they'll try, this is the problem. But actually it would be very useful if you just tell him these are the problems which you can solve, which are solved by most of the users. So this is what the trending problems page looks like. The left side is trending amongst friends. So these are the submissions in the last 15 days across all the websites. All you need to do is go to this page, just select the most trending problem and solve it, because a lot of people are solving it, it might be an interesting problem to solve, right? That. And then we have a problem page. This problem page has a lot of analytics on the problem page, the problem. So I'll just show you the problem page. Yeah. So this is the problem name, messenger. Here is the link, the green part here. Link to the problem, he can actually go to that problem and solve it then. Editorials is basically, it has a lot of editorials which are added in the website itself. Or you can also suggest editorials. I'll just show you in the next slide. The right side is the accuracy graph for the problem. All the submissions submitted on that problem across all the users, you'll see the accuracy graph there, so that you can get to know what kind of problem is it. And there are three tabs, my submissions, friend submissions, global submissions. What you can do is just filter the submissions on that problem based on that, right? you can write an editorial and submit it so that the community knows about it and learns, right? Yeah. So then there's a filter page. So filter is basically, say I remember a friend submission, and it was on some site which was on which gave him memory limit exceeding. So I'll just search for it. Take the name of it. A friend of mine has this handle, TechQuiz, so yeah. And you can select the site and the problem name, and you'll get all the submissions there. So you can just see that code, that what gave him memory limit exceeded, and then you can search for that problem. If the user has solved the exception, then what fixed the problem, right? What fixed the memory limit exceeded problem? Then there's to-do list. So what normally people do is basically go to every site, they remember the problem names, and they'll just come back next day and solve that problem. Now this does not scale in a way, because people would have to stick to a site and they'll have to remember a very few problems, say 2 problems, 3 problems maximum of it. But now you have a unified to-do list across all the competitive programming websites. Now what you can do is just add it to the to-do list and come back later on StopStalk. You just get the problem that you need to solve next. And what you can do is you can see your friend solve problems and you can try adding it to your to-do list. Or you can monitor the trending problems every day and then keep on adding to your to-do list, keep on solving them. Or you can search problems by tags, and many more use cases are there for to-do list, right? So this is what some the problem names is shown, the problem site and the submissions, number of users solved it. You can also remove from to-do list when you're done solving it, right? Yeah. So there is this thing called upcoming contest page. So as I explained earlier, the contests are basically organized by all these sites at particular times, say weekly or say monthly. And they want to know what are the next coming contests so that they can register for it. What they'll do is they'll just open this upcoming contest page. They can see all the list of contests which are coming up, which are already live also. You can see the first 4 are already running. You can go to that contest page. Or you can add a reminder, Google reminder, so that it reminds you 30 minutes before of the contest start. So you can register for it if it requires a registration. Now there is leaderboard. So if you see, all the competitive programming websites are on StopStalk. Now if I define a formula for it, it will be actually the competitive programming progress for the user. So what it includes right now is the streak of the user, accuracy with his, what he is solving the problem, the number of problems he has solved, attempted, and a lot of complex formula is there for this. And we have leaderboard for country, global, institute, every leaderboard. And it looks something like this, the user, the handle, institute from which he is in, the rating. And the last column is per day changes. So what per day changes is basically, say a user registered on StopStalk today. So I'll compute a value called the per day value. So till now, from 2013 first Jan, the number of days and the number of submissions, number of submissions divided by the number of days, I'll compute this value. Say the user submits 1.5 submissions every day. That is the per day value that I store. Once I store that value, I monitor that value and show the difference to the user. If the value is positive, means that he has been solving more submissions after the registration on StopStalk, right? Negative means that he has been very less on the side of solving problems, submitting on the website. So this is a way in which user get motivated to come every day and solve problems every day and learn. Right. Then there is this profile page. So profile page is the main thing where the users are attracted the most. They can see that cumulative profile page of all the sites, and they can see much more data inside it. So I'll just show you the screenshots of it. So there is accuracy streaks, problem solved, also the contest graphs. So graphs are basically of ratings. every competitive programming site has some something called rating. Now the rating is basically determined based on the performance of the user in the contest. So contest graphs are basically the graphs in which there are ratings plotted across that site. I'll just show you that. Submission graph and the list of solved and unsolved problems. So this is what the profile page looks like. These are all the accuracy across all the websites. The day streak and the accepted solution streak. The number of problems he has solved and total. Accuracy graph. Next is this contest graph. So basically what I am talking about is the right side. Code chef long, code chef cook-off, code chef lunchtime. These are the name of the contests which happen at particular intervals. And people just try solving problems on it. And based on that, they have some ratings. And you can see all the rating graphs on StopStalk itself, right? Then there is this. So this is what a DD profile of some competitive programmer would look like when he is submitting a lot, right? Then these are the list of solved problems based on the categories which he has solved. So you can just check. And what these greens and reds are. So green is basically the logged in user has solved the problem. So I'm viewing someone else's profile and I can just see that what all problems I have solved and the user has also solved. So all the blue ones are the ones that the user has solved, but me as a logged in user haven't. So I'll just add it to the to-do list or say ask for help to the user if you get stuck on that problem, right? Yeah, so what is happening behind the scenes? Obviously there's a crawling happening, a lot of crawling. So to give you numbers, if there are 6,000 users, there are 6 sites, there are 36,000, the minimum 36,000 HTTP requests. Where it exceeds is basically the number of pages in the submission. Not every website shows all the submissions on one page. So you have pagination there where you have to crawl it. So so first thought is basically write all the handlers, say code chef handler, code forces handler. You get a username and you return the list of submissions. That is the first thought you get when you say how to solve the problem. How can we do better? We can store the last retrieved timestamp, and every time our handler is called, we'll just break out of that last retrieve so that we can only get the diff of the submissions that the user made, right? So that is a better step after that. One more thing, one more optimization on it is why hit the 404s, right? So users also provide one of the competitive programming website, but they just added their handles. So why hit a 404 every day in a cron of 24 hours, right? So after this optimization state, we still were on like 9 hours for 6,000 users, because there were also a few optimizations and the processing around the submission which happens along with the crawling. It took around 9 hours per day. So how do we scale, right? That's the issue. So what you do is make user a participant of the system. How do you make user help us in the retrieval process? And one insight on the submission is not every user submits every day on every site. A user can't submit on every site. User may, but user can't. User will not, sorry. So that was one of the insight. The other insight was how do you basically capture both of these information and build a solution around it. So what we came up with was a delay value we'll store. The delay value will tell how many days after the retrieval should happen. So basically last retrieve plus the delay value by 5. I'll tell you what this 5 is. If this plus 1 is current date, then skip it. Then don't run the retrieval process for that site. What do you do else is you retrieve the submission. If there was no submissions
retrieved from the user, you increment the delay value. That is when the delay value sometimes gets ahead of 5. And if there were some submissions, that means the user was actually active. You see that if the user was active this day, he'll be active on tomorrow also, maybe. So that is how it's capturing. So after this solution, what we'll be eventually having is if a submission is already done, if there are submissions on it, so then the delay value would keep on getting to zero and the user's data would be retrieved next. Then there's a refresh button which we provide so that user can just get the submissions right then. And we just reset the counters when the refresh button is fresh. So current data set right now is 7 million plus submissions, every day increasing. Around 7,000 users across the world, and total number of problems that we have is 45,000 plus. So future plans would be, so now we have all the data of the user. What we could do is we would track the last submissions of the user and based on that recommend the user some problems to solve, and that would be very helpful for the user. Next would be mobile application, our discussion forum for people to add more sites to software. That would be connect if you want to.
Right.
Thank you.